بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمد ونصلي على رسول الكريم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله we're in the second, we got two chapters left. They're very short chapters. We'll cover one today, and inshallah next week we'll cover the last one. So the chapter today is the 12th chapter, in it being mustahab, that is something that is rewarded, it's good to remember the graves and to think about its condition, or the condition of the graves and the condition of the early Muslims in regards to this. So the first narration for today is Imam Ahmad and Imam Tirmidhi, Hakim and so forth narrated the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu from Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, meaning more or less, istahyu min Allah haqqa li haya, have haya, shame from Allah, his right to have shame. The Sahaba radiallahu anhu replied, Ya Rasulullah, we inna nastahi walhamdulillah, that we have haya, that we have modesty, alhamdulillah. He said, not that istihya, that the right of Allah to have haya, modesty before Allah, shame before Allah, as his right to have modesty, is that you protect the head and what it contains. That you protect the head of the body and what it contains. Protect it from sins and disobedience of Allah and displeasure of Allah. What it contains is many of the senses. Protect the eyes, protect the ears, protect the tongue, etc. from that which is displeasing. That's haya. One is to say to have haya. One is the reality of haya. It manifests in how we, the first thing the Rasulullah said, that we abstain from, that we protect our limbs, our head, and what it contains. وَأَنْ تَحْفَزَ الْبَطْنَ وَمَا حَوَى, and to the same with the stomach, the belly, and what it encompasses, meaning what we consume. And to remember death and the decaying. This is part of haya before Allah. So to protect the head and what it contains, protect the stomach, to protect the belly, and to protect the, and this also extends out to all the limbs, that protect our limbs from sins. In the commentaries you find this as well, to protect the head and the organs that are in the head, and then the belly, and what extends from it is the rest of the limbs. Because the energy, or the what we get for what we do with our hands and feet, right, is coming from the belly. And consuming halal, I always mention this, halal is, one is the actual earnings, our earnings are halal. Second thing is the thing that we consume is also halal. If you use halal money to buy pork, your money is halal, but then you buy something that is haram. Or the thing is, the money is from stolen wealth, but you make sure that, you know, it's 100% halal certified, but the money source is haram. So it's got to be halal on all levels. And then the third thing Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, to remember death and the decaying. To remember the death and the decaying, meaning the withering away of the body, the kafan and so forth in the grave. And whoever wants the akhirah, وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةَ تَرَكَ زِينَةَ الدُّنْيَا, whoever intended, whoever wanted akhirah, he left the beautification of this dunya, the adornment of this dunya, right? So the head and what it contains, the stomach, the belly, the death and its decay, to remember death, and is this something should be there in front of the person. For who the one who has haqqal haya, that he really knows, he really has shame before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever wants akhirah, then he should leave the adornment, the zenith of the dunya. This is a haqqal haya, that he cannot get caught up in the dunya. You can have nice things, but it can never, the bling can never, this person that has haqqal haya, because he knows Allah's watching. He's so cognizant of Allah, he has really is the haqq of haya, that the dunya doesn't distract him. That the flashiness, the bling of this dunya, the zina of this dunya, however you want to define it, but in our terms, it doesn't distract him. فَمَنْ فَعْلَ فَقَدْ إِسْتَحْيَ مِنَ اللَّهِ حَقَّ الْحَيَاءِ, the Prophet ﷺ said that whoever does this, then he has truly, has shame from Allah, the haqq of haya, modesty. I would translate shame, modesty, before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the, I was reading the commentary of Dalil al-Falihin explains in their detail what haya is. And like one of the examples is given that what's haya is that to feel a sense of shame in the heart, knowing what Allah has done for you and that your inability to repay him back, right? His ihsan, his kindness from his side is complete, perfect. And from our side, everything is deficient, so you feel shame. Another example is that imagine if we're in our vehicle with one of our parents and you see something haram that you shouldn't look at, and your mother's sitting there or father's sitting there, then we don't look. We shouldn't look out of taqwa, but why don't we look? Because this person has done so much ihsan on me that I don't want to do anything that is will disturb them, upset them, right? So that's for a human relationship even as well, like we have that. But haqqul haya are these things that a person cannot be, he protects, stays away from all the deceit because he knows Allah's watching. He's careful about everything that he does. And he's aware of the reality of death and his reality of this dunya in comparison to the akhirah. Mu'anaman arad, whoever intends, wants akhirah, success of akhirah, then he leaves the beautification, the adornments, chasing after the bling of this dunya. Another narration, Imam Tabarani and others have narrated, hadith of Aisha radiallahu anhu, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he said upon the, similar to this, on the mimbar, on the pulpit, and the people are around him, and they said that they remember the grave, not in the first narration is mentioned death, the second narration, but the same contents, except the only difference was that to remember the graves and its decaying, decayment, or I'm not sure what the right word is, billah, the decaying in the grave. And he kept on repeating this. The Prophet ﷺ kept on repeating to remember death, graves and its decaying. Remember the graves, and he kept on repeating this until you could hear they were all crying around the mimbar. Yabkuna hawla al-mimbar. You could hear them, all these grown men, these people that were, they fought in battles. These are not soft, whatever you want to call them, like us today. These are people that are took the full responsibility of Islam and spreading Islam and defended Islam. And he said, and they around the mimbar, you could hear them sobbing and crying. Until not just those sobbing quietly, could hear them. The Rasulullah kept on repeating it. Obviously, if the khatib is Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it doesn't need to be. It's self-explanatory. Imam Tirmizi narrated, and Imam Hakim also has narrated, the hadith of Asma bint Umays that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the worst slave of Allah, who bi'sul abdi, the worst slave, right? The worst slave of Allah is the one who fancies himself and he's vain. He fancies himself and he's vain. And he forgets he forgets al-kabir, he forgets the greatest, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he forgets al-muta'ali, the most lofty, the highest. Then Rasulullah said, the worst slave of Allah is the one that forces and is hostile. And he forgets al-jabbar al-a'la. He forgets the, like he forces, he's like, he's in his attitude, he's like, I'm saying just to explain, that this person is hostile and forcing, is tyrannical in his behavior. And he forgets, while he's doing this, he forgets the compeller, al-jabbar al-a'la, and the highest, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, the worst slave is the one that he is heedless, and is saha wa laha. He's heedless and he's like forgetful and diverted, like he's forgotten, like he's totally turned away. And he forgets the graves, why this hadith is mentioned here, and walbila, this thing repeats in graves. He's turned and he diverted, he's distracted, he's heedless in his life. And he forgot what? He forgot the graves and the decaying in the graves. And the worst slave is the one who is violent and tyrannical. He's violent and tyrannical, and he forgot the beginning, mubtada wal muntaha. He forgot the beginning and the end, muntaha. He forgot his beginning, where he came from and where he's going. And the best, and sorry, I keep saying the best, the worst slave, bi'sal abd yakhtalu duni bid-din, he said that he, like he seeks the dunya with his deen. That he seeks the dunya with his deen. And the worst slave is the one that he seeks the deen with shubha. The worst slave is the one that he like does away with his deen with shubhat, that he seeks the worldly things with the doubtful matters. He destroys his deen in going to doubtful matters. And the worst slave is the one that his desires, his greed, tama'un yaqudu, that he's led by his desires. His tama', his greed, like intense greed, avarice, this leads him, that becomes his leader. Like his own greed is becomes leads him in his life. And the worst slave is the one that his lusts mislead him. بِئْسُ الْعَبْدِ عَبْدٌ هَوَى يُضِلُّ, that his desires mislead him, these lusts mislead him. And the worst slave is the one is that his slaves, the worst slave is a slave. That he desires, and that because of those desires, it is a source of humiliation. يُذِلُّهُ الْبِئْسُ الْعَبْدِ عَبْدٌ رَقِبَ يُذِلُّهُ, that he desires, he has desires for things, and then that is a source of humiliation for him. In the next narration, I mean, this is a condition of, it's our condition. We're forgetful, and if you look at all the things, we do wrong to people, and we do zulm to people, and we forget the grave, and we forget our beginning and end, and the dunya is used for to get the dunya. People sell their, for dunya, they sell their deen, they compromise their deen. For shubuhat, you see that today, like people, there's famous ones in different countries. They go after the part of deen, where it can cause doubts to become, you know, like interest is haram, and then they'll make a video on how it's halal. So it's not even a shubha, it's actually clear cut in Islam, but they created now a shubha. And so what are the, it's actually the, you know, in the, one of the things in the, especially in Western academia, is a sickness, like they always have to come up with something new, you know, like it's a constant thing. Someone goes to university and studies and so forth, it's like you always have to put, as a Muslim, you have to be like put a little bit of brakes on, because the way we study deen is study the old things and try to get that right. But the sort of like a secular education, there's a benefit to ikhtira', coming up with new things as well, but not in deen. But some people do that, and then they like rocking the boat, because that's there's a saying in Arabic. My father, rahmullah, used to say, "Khalif tu'raf," oppose and you become known. There's many of those. Pakistan is so many YouTubers. I won't mention any names, but like what everybody's known always. And this, there's a hadith actually, I think mentioned in my series on Qiyamah, that people will come. You didn't hear about it. Your father didn't hear about it. You know, now they're saying, no, this is okay. This is now permissible. This is now something like 100. Especially if your parents were following ulama, or they were ulama, or they were studying, following ulama haq. It's not like we're talking about any parents. Like generally, our seniors, and many, it's possible they could have done many things wrong. But generally the good things, the right things, you know, like those are things we should be taking, even from our parents and grandparents and so forth. So people are coming with things that are, you never heard before, and they make it a point of contention. So these people, they're selling their akhirah, they're using this for something else, which is fame and name and recognition. Khalif tu'raf, oppose and you become known. If you follow the straight and narrow and toe the line, not many people will pay attention. So you got to rock the boat to get attention. Ibn Abi Dunya, with this chain of narration, is narrated that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a man said to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Who is the one who has the most zuhud? Man azhadun nas? Who's the one who has most biraghbati, indifference to the dunya?" He's Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, من لم ينسى القبر والبلا, the one who has not forgotten the grave and is decaying. Who has the most turned his heart away from the dunya, which is something that is desired in deen. Zuhud is a characteristic. There's whole chapters in fiqh books, in hadith literature especially. There's a section on raqa'iq and zuhud. The heart softness and the things that will turn us away from this dunya. It's a desired characteristic, something we should strive for. Zuhud, indifference, in Urdu say biraghbati, having indifference to the dunya, turning the heart away from the dunya. This is something that is something, and the signs, ulama write on it, and the signs how to recognize that you have this quality. Imam Ghazali, rahimahullah, you know, he said that zuhud is, he said, how do you know you have zuhud? He said, when you get the thing, you don't feel happy. And when you lose some dunya, you don't get upset. Meaning you have indifference to the dunya. You have zuhud from dunya. If you're attached to it, if you lose it, you feel upset, that means you're still attached to the dunya. And if you get it, then you're celebrating on, you know, money or properties and things. That means you love, you're not a zahid. So the first sign to recognize, whether you get it or lose it, it's the same. Praise and criticism of people is the same. People say, wahwa, mashallah, you know, you are like this. And people criticize you, it's the same. People say good things about you. Someone put this on the YouTube and someone with a bad comment, you know, do I feel it in my heart? I mean, like, if you're getting affected by what praise and blame of people is the same. Mm-hmm. And the third sign is, so whether you get something, lose something, the same, whether you praise and blame is the same. And third one is when you have lazza in your ibadah, when you have enjoyment in your ibadah. Because why? To enjoy ibadah, your heart has to be detached from the dunya. And this, you know, it has to be detached. You can be a billionaire, but if you want to be a zahid, your heart cannot be attached to dunya. A Muslim can be rich, but he can't be a dunya dar, as we say, like, he's a person of dunya. He can be wealthy, he can be a successful businessman, but he can't be a person of dunya. Like, when I say dunya, like, that becomes the maqsad and purpose of his life. And if that is the purpose of the life of a person, that he's made it like that, he can be good at dunya, but he can't be a person of dunya. It's something that go through the whole Quran, and on nearly every page you'll see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about dunya and how you should be. And what we're told, that not to be fooled by this dunya. Even if you're a billionaire, millionaire, or a $1 heir, whatever you are, it cannot be attached. Because you can have nothing and still desire all the dunya. Sometimes we become like, we're nothing, we want everything. So it doesn't mean about whether you have it or not, it's about where the condition of your heart is. So the Sahabi wanted the clarification, this man wanted the clarification, that who's the one who has the most of this. So the hadith, izhad, in terms of encouragement for zuhud, izhad fi dunya yuhibbukallah, have indifference to the dunya, and Allah will love you. Wazhad fima inda nas yuhibbukan nas, have indifference to what people possess, and the people will love you. And it came on the back of a question, I want Allah to love me and the people to love me. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you want Allah to love you, have biraghbah, indifference to the dunya. You know, it doesn't mean like burn your money and become homeless and start begging. That's not what it means. And so Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in quick answer to his question, who's the one who has the most of this? He said, the one who doesn't forget about the grave and the decaying in the grave. The one who left the extra of the dunya, the additional bonus, or you could say, beyond his needs, and he has preferred. وَتَرَكَ فَضْلَ الدُّنْيَا, right? وَآثَرَ مَا يَبْقَى لَمَا يَفْنَى. He has preferred that what is permanent, that is eternal, forever, enduring, the akhirah, over what will perish. And he doesn't consider وَلَمْ يُعَدُّ غَدًا مِنْ أَيَّامِ. He doesn't consider, he doesn't count tomorrow as one of his days. Like, he doesn't, like, tomorrow I'll be alive. That's not, I don't know if I'll be alive tomorrow. And وَعَدَّ نَفْسَهُ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْقُبُورِ. He counts himself as one of the people of the grave already, that he's already there. Right? So he's already considered himself a person of Akhirah. He's one of the people of the grave, because that's a certainty we're all going to go there. So he's already considered himself with people of the grave. He's not considered people of tomorrow, that tomorrow this is going to happen, I'm going to get this, I'm going to get that. Mentioned another narration that Rasulullah, it's a famous hadith, you probably heard this, that Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu said, Rasulullah took me by my shoulder, and this is for emphasis, he held him, and or on his shoulder, or on both shoulders, he held him, كُنْ فِي الدُّنْيَا كَأَنَّكَ غَرِيبٌ عَابِرُ السَّبِيلِ. Be in the world as though you're a stranger or like a traveler, and consider yourself from the people of the graves. I mean, this hadith is the attitude of a Muslim. Be in the dunya like a stranger, like a stranger. Remember when you first came to Doncaster, we never lived here, and or this town. So you don't know where the shops are. You don't know timing of things. You don't know the streets real. You're an outsider. After a while, you become familiar, become a local. So gharib is someone, an outsider, out of towner. He comes into the town. He doesn't know where all the places are. He's lost a little bit, but he's there. So consider being the dunya like that. Your attitude towards the dunya should be like that. Like these Muslims that go on about mastering all the dunya and so forth. Well, the deen tells us the opposite. Actually, the Sahaba's success is this. Because who's he telling? Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum. They took this to heart. They knew, they were people that were not, they knew who Allah was, they knew Rasulullah, they knew deen. And their successes were because of deen. And Abir al-Sabir, be like a stranger. Like a traveler. Like a passerby, a wayfarer that you're just passing through. And you're not here to build some long-term thing. You're just a traveler. You're stopping at a station. In our terms, today, we stop at a station. You don't invest a lot into the station and the stopover at the station. You're there for a temporary time, or you stop around a tree on a way, on a journey, or stop at a petrol station, examples that we can relate to. That's being the dunya. The dunya, the life of this dunya is like that. It's just a stopover. We're going to leave it. And consider yourself, count yourselves among the people of the graves. Another, now the next few, just at the end of this, it's a whole advices of one of the great khalifas of Islam. You can read his biography, whole books are written on him. His khilaf is only about 2 years or so. And he, Rahimahullah, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the second Umar, considered the Mujaddid, the reviver of Islam in his century. And he said, someone came to visit him, and he said, he was sitting in his as a khalifa, Amir al-Mu'mineen, and he said that a whole night I spent thinking. He said, because in what, ya Amir al-Mu'mineen? You know, I mean, what was it? He said, I was thinking about the grave and those who are living in the grave, the inhabitant of the grave. And he said, if you see the dead body after 3 days, what happens to it? He said that you will not, like you'll be scared to come near it. And he said, and you see how it decays and how it pus flows out of it, and he said the worms come into it, and the smell changes, and the coffin, the shroud, withers away. And what you used to be a beautiful person, you used to be a nice smelling person, and very, very, very clean and very nice clothes they used to wear in the dunya. But because then he started talking like this and he fainted. He started talking like this because until he swooned and then he fainted. He mentioned another narration about him as well. One of the persons said, I visited Ka'b, Muhammad ibn Ka'b al-Quradi, said, I visited Umar al-Aziz and I came upon him. I looked at him, he's changed totally. Because before his khilafah, he was a different person. The weight of the khilafah was so much on him, and like the responsibility. He was governor of Medina, Munawwara, before in Makkah and so forth. But he said after, because when I kept on looking, because he was shocked at how much he's physically changed. And he said that, are you looking at me? Because you're seeing somebody. إِنَّكَ لَتَنْظُرُ إِلَيَّ نَظْرًا مَا كُنْتَ تَنْظُرُهُ إِلَيَّ بِالْمَدِينَ. You're looking at something that you did not see. As though you're looking at somebody you don't, like the way I used to look in Medina Munawwara. He said, yes, Amir al-Mu'mineen. I mean, it's a very short amount of time, a year or two. And he goes, I'm kind of bewildered or amazed at the condition of your skin, like color, like how it's changed, and how I can only wonder how your body, the condition of your body is. And he said, O Ibn Ka'b, how will it be when you see my body after 3 days in the grave? And he goes, and how my eyeballs have come on my cheeks, and the pus comes out of my body, and the worms from my nostrils. He goes, that's going to be worse than what you see now. You see me in this condition, my body's condition. What you see when you see me in the grave, it's going to be a worse condition. Another narration mentioned that a man, a scholar, a jurist, that entered in the presence of Umar ibn al-Aziz, And he says, Subhanallah. He was shocked when he saw his condition. Like the Umar al-Aziz, he says, Subhanallah. And he said that, he goes, you've changed. تَغَيَّرْتَ بَعْدًا. Like, you changed after you left us in Medina. Like, you come here. What's happened to you? Like, he said, and then he's like, basically started talking. And then similar to the previous one. And he said, how will be in the condition? Don't worry about this. Don't worry about this condition, because the just gave a description similar to the previous one and what happened in the grave. And then there's another one where Umar ibn Aziz, rahmatullah alayhi, he passed by janaza. He prepared the janaza of a family, a relative. And then he turned to his companions. Allah give us khalifas like this. Because our condition is not good as individuals and as rulers. And he admonished his family after preparing, doing all the janaza and everything. And he said to his, and then he reminded about dunya and criticized it. And then he reminded about the people of dunya and the enjoyments of the dunya. And then what will happen to them when they go to the grave. And then he says, when you pass by them in the grave, call them, invite them like they used to invite them. Pass by their groups. Look at look at how close the graves are, their houses are next to each other. In dunya, people have big acreages and big properties and far away from each other. And he said, ask their rich, where's their wealth? When the Khalifa talks like this, you can consider maybe what the poor person, the pious average Muslim, is a special person. He said, what remained of their wealth? Ask the poor that where their faqr, where's their poverty? Ask them about the soft skin, all the moisturizer that was used. Ask them about that, what happened to that? Ask about their... what happened to the eyes? They used to look at enjoyable things. Ask them what's under their kafan now with their body. And he kept on going. It's a page long. We won't go through it. But he's asking, where are their treasures? Where are the things that they collected in the world? And it's a long admonition about to the people around him. And then the last one, I'll read it to you. It's a translation. I've got a better translation. This is the last khutbah that Umar ibn al-Aziz he gave before he passed away. O people, you were not created in vain, nor will be left to yourselves. Rather, you will return to a place in which Allah Most High will descend in order to judge among you and distinguish between you. Destitute and lost are those who forsake the all-encompassing mercy of Allah Most High, and they'll be excluded from Jannah, borders of which are as wide as the heavens and the earth. Don't you know that protection tomorrow will be limited to those who fear Allah today, and to those who sold some things short-lived for something permanent, sometimes something small for something great, and fear for protection. Don't you realize that you are the descendants of those who have perished, that those who remain will take their place after you, and that this will continue until you are all returned to Allah Most High. Every day you follow the coffin of so-and-so who died after the end of his lifetime. Then you place him in the ground and leave him without a pillow or a bed. He has parted from his loved ones, severed his connections with the living, and taken up residence in the earth, whereupon he comes face to face with his reckoning, carrying only his good deeds. Indeed, he needs his accomplishments, but not the material things he left on earth. Thereafter, fear Allah before death descends and is appointed, and its appointed time expires. I swear by Allah that I say those words to you, knowing that I myself have committed more sins than any of you. I therefore ask Allah Most High for forgiveness, and I repent. He then it mentions that he then lifted the edge of his robe to his face and began to cry and sob. Then he stepped down. That was the last khutbah sermon he gave before he died. May Allah have mercy on his soul. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. So Umar al-Aziz is an interesting person. When he was young in Medina Munawwara, he was pious, but in Medina before he became governor, he said, I desired governorship Medina, I got that. Then I desired Khilafah, I got that. Now I desire something much bigger, it's Jannah. And when he was young, he was in Medina Munawwara. From his mother's side, he's from his granddaughter of Umar bin Khattab. And he set the standard of fashion in Medina Munawwara as a young man. So you can fill in the gaps, what type of, he was an interesting person. But when Khilafah came to him, he was he really revived the Khulafa al-Rashideen's standard. That's he showed. despite being in the middle of Banu Umayyah and all the things that were happening around. And Banu Umayyah was famous in there, all sorts of characters. There was a Sahaba as well, and there was non-Sahaba, and it was a dynasty, right? But in the middle of that, this person comes out of left field, and he revived, this is the gold standard of like what Khilafah should look like, and set an example for the Ummah. He's the one that in the khutbah, you know, at the end of the khutbah, what's the last bit that every khatib reads in the Jummah khutbah, and second khutbah. I know it, I say it every week. Now I've gone blank. He's the one to stop all propaganda, criticisms within khutbas. Because the Alawi, the people support Ali radiallahu anhu, so forth. You know, one used to attack the other side, the other one used to attack khutbas. In khutbas, this used to happen. He put a stop to that. And that became like a step. From that time till our time, that's become like every khatib all over the world repeats those words, because it summarizes all the teachings of Islam and akhlaq and so forth. So he was an amazing, amazing person. And too many examples, and whole books are written on him and his piety. Like somebody came to see his wife. She was a daughter of another khalifa, one of the Banu Umayyah khalifa, Abd al-Malik Marwan or somebody. She came to see Amir al-Mu'mineen's wife. She's a governor's wife or something. She came to see, and she saw him, and there's a man painting the wall with the mud, you know, like replastering the wall. And she said, Oh, the wife of the Amir al-Mu'mineen, don't you make hijab from the servants? And he said, that is Amir al-Mu'mineen. That is the one that you're calling the painter, you know, because that's Amir al-Mu'mineen. So, like, he really was an amazing person. His life is his piety and so forth. And you can see his condition in the words that he says. Allah preserves it in the books. And as an admonishment for us, inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us understanding and tawfiq. Next week, inshallah, will be the last recording. Yeah, it's only a couple of pages. But it's the zikr kalimat muntakhab min kalam salaf salih. Some more words from the early Muslims, the righteous early Muslim, the pious predecessors, in regards to take admonition from the graves. So these are just miscellaneous and some scattered pearls that he's gathered at the end. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us understanding. Subhanallah bihamdi, subhanakallah bihamdi, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun, wa salamun alal mursalin, walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.